Gosh, there's an awful lot of prime numbers in this date. It makes me happy. Ryzen launched this week.
Yeah, Ryzen launch, depending on where your bias lays, this was the most successful CPU launch in the history of the world, or just treasonous lies, and they should all be hanged for what they did.
Yeah, things have gotten a little partisan with this, I think. I really think that AMD has done something really tremendous here, and they're going to probably take over the universe. And yeah, some of the numbers and some of the benchmarks are, you know, not, you know, it's like the 7700K is hard to compete with, but you really sort of have to dot the I's and cross the T's and see how it actually plays out in the long term, because I really think that it's going to be an amazing thing.
Well, I think you're just an apologist in an AMD show, and they failed completely with it. They'll never recover from this.
Clearly. Oh, Lord.
But it turns out this is not the first time a major CPU launch has been a little screwed up.
They're a little problematic. I mean, the Pentium D, when that launched, was basically just two Pentium 4s sewn together, slapped on a single chip, and it's like, well, let's just call it a day. The Intel scheduler, I mean, the scheduler in Windows had a lot of problems with that. The X99 launch, let's not forget about the X99 launch. Jesus, that was a mess. And Xeon CPUs from X99, those were so rushed and buggy. There were bugs in silicon that could not be fixed with microcode updates. Anybody remember the early stepping Xeons? Xeons that are supposed to have the most validation and testing and, you know, just very thorough bugs in silicon. They had to do new stepping.
It may be that it's just with every iteration of CPU releases, we get more and more hype. It's more and more the age of hype. So the bitterness and the betrayal feels worse because, you know, they've drip fed you that that codeine, that opiate.
They got you all hyped up.
And you got you hyped up, and then things get weird. Now, for those of you hoping that this whole news show is going to be about Ryzen, it's not.
Well, so it does seem to be the new kind of marketing, like the new kind of like thing for advertising companies to do is to like try to focus your advertising on that. So I guess like we're in the, you know, at the early 20th century, you had like the Bernays type approach to marketing. What's this approach to marketing where you literally just get people so hyped up they lose their damn minds?
We should coin a name for it. I can't come up with anything.
Something that combines crack cocaine and partisanship in one word. Drugging them out, drugged out of their mind.
Something
I don't know.
Dealer.
Alt facts dealer. No, yeah, this is definitely not going to be all about Ryzen. We are doing a video on Ryzen. It's not anywhere near complete yet because not everything is done. And for those of you that might say that AMD really rushed the release and they should have worked more with vendors and OEMs and stuff like that to figure it out, I don't blame AMD for being a little bit gun-shy when it comes to the market. And this time they really seem to work with enthusiasts ahead of OEMs and ahead of all of the other stuff. I think because that they knew that there was going to be a software component that had to sort of play catch up. And so, you know, anybody that's like, wait a minute, well, there's this really old story from 2016. Intel still hasn't paid the $1.2 billion antitrust fine from the Eurozone, I guess, Europe and the EU. For those that don't remember, there was sort of a situation in Europe where Intel was paying companies like Dell money not to use competitors' products, which included AMD. And, you know, the questionable legality of that aside, that kind of stuff, I could see why that would make AMD gunshot about going to Microsoft and large OEMs to be like, hey, this is how we're going to do this. So, you know, instead they chose to work with board manufacturers and get a bunch of boards out and that kind of thing. But it is a completely new architecture and a completely new chipset and requires different software optimizations. Like as of this video, there's a problem with the Windows scheduler and how it schedules threads on the CPU. And there's a really awesome computer science-y explanation for that, and it makes perfect sense. And so that's why it's like, oh, we're going to release benchmarks and do day one benchmarks. No, we're not. We're going to do some motherboard reviews and talk about some stuff. I've done a lot of testing on Linux. The IOMMU groups for GPU pass-through, that's still broken. But a lot of other stuff's fixed. Memory clocks on, you know, up to 3200. If you really want the nitty-gritty details, you can check my Twitter. I've been tweeting things as I've been assembling data for an article. But, you know, honestly, it's probably going to be a while before we do an article. So that's enough Ryzen.
And that's why you don't pre-order.
Yeah, and that's why you don't pre-order. That's exactly right. Now that Ryzen's out of the way, What do we actually have to talk about in the news?
It was a little thin this week. Something tells me that a lot of the tech coverage was taken up.
Eclipsed by the, the Ryzen of the CPU. Sorry.
DNA databases. There's been a lot of debate about whether or not there should be a federal DNA database. Of course, there is. But there's also little hometown DNA databases.
DNA database. Was that wrong? Should we not have done that?
So it takes as much as 18 months to get to ship off your DNA sample and get the federal database to check it. So what many police departments have done is just started their own. So when they arrest you, they'll swab you. They have like consent forms that you can sign. It's like, oh, sure, you can swab me. And a lot of people don't know what they're signing. They're like, oh, cops give me a paper. I better sign it. So they're doing their own. They're having the test done by private labs. Hmm. And how are they paying for it? Asset forfeiture. So
pretty, it's a vicious cycle.
Yeah, pretty Orwellian. No one's sure exactly how many because they don't have to report. This is completely sort of like cowboy stuff. There's no regulation at all. But a lot of local police departments have a DNA database.
Hmm. Well, that sounds like pretty top-down leadership. We're going to take your DNA and make you pay for it.
Pretty much. So, yeah, read anything that any authority gives you to sign.
Wow. I mean, this article is just, it's completely nuts. It is completely, completely nuts because you know that local police department that got Crypto Locker last week is totally going to handle your DNA properly.
Yeah, right. There's going to be no leak of that.
Speaking of databases behaving badly, WordPress, there's a WordPress plugin that has over 1 million installs that has an SQL injection.
This seems like every week we get some sort of injection attack, and it's always just bad login, no sanitization. This one's the same thing. It's called the Next Gen Image Gallery. So if you're running a WordPress site with Next Gen Image Gallery,
it's already too late. Just letting you know now.
So you can run pretty much any kind of code you want by passing that Next Gen bad values.
Now, the interesting thing about this is not the vulnerability in and of itself. It's that this is sort of the last in a string of security incidents around WordPress the last couple of months, or last two or three months, I think. And even the security flaws is not really the interesting part. The interesting part is that the criminal element or whatever are using these infected WordPress installs to infect more WordPress installs. So it spreads over the internet like a virus, which is getting into very dangerous territory.
Now, we should note this is not the WordPress core.
Yes.
This is a plugin. I'm not that WordPress core can be trusted, but...
Well, you're not going to be using the plugin without WordPress.
Right, exactly.
So, but once the plugin has compromised the system, you can do, you know, whatever you want, whatever your, I guess your web server user has permissions to do, which is usually quite a lot. I mean, it's like, oh, it's totally normal for the web server to make outbound internet connections and mine Bitcoin. That's completely, completely normal. And then, you know, infect more servers and that kind of thing. It's also completely normal for your stuffed animals to spy on you.
I think, was it last week we talked about Germany has crazy laws against this?
Yeah.
Well, I say crazy, but...
Is it really?
Is it really crazy?
We said it was crazy. Apparently, we were wrong.
So, the Cloud Pets, I had not heard of the Cloud Pets. So, the Cloud Pet, the idea is you get it, and there's an app on your phone, I guess. So, when you're traveling or, you know, grandma who lives in another state, whatever, can, like, record messages, and the Cloud Pet will relay them to the child, and then vice versa. Hmm. So they had a very interesting security problem.
Yeah, their MongoDB database was just open to the internet.
No password.
No password.
No authentication of any kind.
Yeah, it was just on the net. It's a wildly popular product. And it's like, oh, wait, we didn't expect to sell millions upon millions of these. We've been busy.
And this is not even, like, you don't, the word hacker doesn't apply here. There are websites that will just crawl the internet and try to find open databases, and it found it. So this would, you could, you know, like just go find a list. It's like, oh, Cloud Pets. And many, many people tried to tell them about it, but apparently they don't care.
Oh, whoops. I bet they care now.
So if you've You got a cloud pet. You gotta put a bag over its head or something.
This kind of thing can happen sometimes too when you take the assembly line workers and then you get them a, you know, learn MongoDB in 24 hours and just, you know, copy paste their product together.
I wonder if it wasn't like, okay, we've got the guys, they've got it working. It's totally fine. We're ready to launch. Let's get rid of them. We don't need them anymore. And then nobody told them that was the development server. For whatever you do, don't put this out there on the internet.
Don't put it on the internet. Yeah. That's like, wait, it's not working on the internet. I know. Let's put the thing on the internet and then it'll be fine. It's like, well, that's a hard lesson to learn. You ever take a CAPTCHA, like do a CAPTCHA and then fail the CAPTCHA and then suddenly question, you know, your own existence, have a little mini existential crisis?
CAPTCHAs are terrible things and they're annoying and you hate them until you get on the other side of it and have to go through like 30 pages of contact form spam. And you're like, oh, okay, those are valuable.
Yeah. You know, it's us versus the robots. What if you employ robots to defeat robots?
In this case, Google's reCAPTCHA can be defeated by Google's voice recognition API.
Now, this is interesting because when you take when you do the reCAPTCHA thing, you get an image. But if you're visually impaired, there's an alternative link to actually let you listen to something to do the CAPTCHA that way. And so this is not a visual defeat of the CAPTCHA. If you're thinking, it's like, wait, how does the speech recognition come into play? Well, there's most CAPTCHAs in Google's CAPTCHA system has an audio alternative. And that's what's been defeated by Google's own speech recognition API.
You just feed it to the speech recognition, and whatever that returns, you put in the box and defeats them pretty much every time.
So I think we need to save this kind of thing in the future, guys. Like when somebody, like as a security researcher, discovers this, when Google accidentally creates Skynet is when you need to release this, not before, so that Google will eat itself.
Turn Google's API against itself. That'd be the great end to the Terminator novel, wouldn't it?
It's like Terminator versus Terminator. But it's just... For them, it would really be an existential crisis because they wouldn't be moving around exoskeletons anymore. They'd be too busy to like move their limbs. It would all be an electronic battle. Just everything just kind of grinds to a halt. And then we go back to like 1970s level technology. It'd be great. What's going on? Well, the WC3 has saw fit to include DRM and HTML5. Well, another form of DRM because they're sort of indicated they were heading in this direction previously. And this is a little bit more of the same.
I can't remember the guy's name.
Tim Berners-Lee.
He is now defending putting DRM directly into the HTML5 plan. And a lot of people are like, this has no business here. This is not, HTML5 should be open. It should not support this kind of thing. His defense is DRM is here. We can't ignore it. These companies are going to have it no matter what. We might as well put it in the standard.
And it's interesting that it's coming from Tim Berners-Lee, which is really why we included the article. I mean, I don't think there's any amount of money in the world that would cause him to shill, as it were. So it is interesting to try to read this and to try to see his perspective on the problem and the sort of loss of control for the consumer over their digital media and their rights and goods and things like that. It's almost, I mean, at times you read the article and it does read a little bit like he's negotiating with terrorists, but you know, he does make some good arguments. So I don't know. Read it and decide.
The arguments are okay, but I feel like it's a slippery slope.
It is definitely a slippery slope.
You're never going to get an inch of that ground back once you give it up.
Yeah, that's true.
So you have to pretty much dig your heels in earlier rather than later, I think.
Media companies, you ever know anybody that is just completely, completely unreasonable and they just like badger you and badger you and badger you until it's like in some parallel universe, you can kind of maybe sort of squint your eyes and see some tiny piece of what they're asking for that's maybe reasonable, and then you give it to them, and then it's just, it's...
and then they're going through your pockets.
Yeah, it's really just... But it's that, but media companies.
It does look like it's going to happen. So there's going to be DRM in the HTML5 standard.
This is a Canadian DMCA story?
Yeah, this is Nintendo has won a huge suit. I think it was $12.7 million. Canadian has the what do they call it?
The anti-electronic modification stuff. Like you can't mod.
Yeah, but they have a different name for it. But anyway, their idea of copyright, even if you don't copy anything, if you just bypass the controls, that's just as bad. in Canadian law, you know, recent Canadian law. So Nintendo sued a mod chip company, and the mod chip company tried the old argument of, hey, we don't offer anything, any copyright material. You can use homebrew. We're not telling people what to do with this. We're just giving them the ability to do it. Well, they say, no, you're bypassing controls. You're not allowed to do that. $12.7 million is what they owe. Which, to Nintendo, I mean, that's like everybody gets another piece of pie this week in the cafeteria. But to these guys, it's probably going to destroy their business.
Yeah, definitely. I can't imagine, like, even if you're getting stuff directly off the wafer from China, those guys didn't make 12 point whatever million in the entire history of their business, I don't think.
I think it was 22,000 per infringement to get to 11.7, and then another million punitive.
Wow.
So yeah, they're almost certainly done.
Well, they're coming for the locksmiths next.
Now, this is Canada, but it wouldn't shock me if they use this to try to get laws like this going. And with the FCC that we've got now, I don't know.
The next story is neat because it is a cautionary tale for, in this case, business working against government. But as we read and go over the story, I want you to think about business working with and for government in the same sort of context. Uber has used a software tool to identify and sidestep code enforcement officials.
Now, they called this grayballing. The actual name of the software was Grayball until people started to look at it. Now it's like terms of service violation or something like that. So what they would do is they had this sort of AI that would use various metrics to try and identify people who might be trying to use Uber to figure out that Uber is being used in places where it's not legal to use Uber. So if this AI could figure out that you were a city official, which isn't hard, it knows where to look. And
if you've got the Uber app installed on your phone, it's got location data. It's like, this guy spent 7 hours at City Hall today.
It would simply spoof everything about Uber that's going on in your city. So it would show you fake cars driving around. It would announce a pickup time and place, and no car would ever show up. It'd just be totally fake.
That's neat. I really like, okay, so the computer science part of me is like, bravo, guys, this is really amazing. And it's like, yeah, let's fight the man and all that. But then the other part of me is like, well, wait a minute. Businesses are probably doing this with the government in other business sectors, and the software is getting good. This is the kind of scary stuff that you should be afraid of with pervasive and ubiquitous technology, because it's like, what if Apple wanted to cooperate and do something with whatever Apple has access to? Or what if some other app company, like, I don't know, the Pokemon Go thing, like, what if that was co-opted by some intelligence agency? You don't know. You don't know.
Yeah, I could totally see Apple, and we got a story coming up about this a little bit later, like, identify who is likely to be a right to repair advocate or has the technical level high enough to actually make these repairs and misdirect them somehow.
Yeah, it's like, oh, you're going to the right to repair rally? Oh, it's going to be in the basement of the the central police station.
I could definitely see that happening. And it's a little chilling. It's also, I'm pretty sure, totally illegal what they did in terms of, the way that their app, like, it claims one thing, and then to send you on a goose chase into a possibly dangerous neighborhood or something like that, they could definitely, that'll bite them pretty hard, especially when they mess with the government.
Yeah, I mean, you could go down some really dark rabbit holes then. Yeah. Let's just, I don't know what to make of that. Well, Bitcoin is worth more than an ounce of gold now. One Bitcoin, I guess.
I don't know if it still is. It probably is. But this week it hit there for the first time ever. Wow. So gold is considered, kind of a benchmark in terms of the economy. What is 1 ounce of gold worth? It's a measure of inflation and blah, blah, blah. Not as reliable as it once was, but it's impressive that Bitcoin is now at least there.
At least temporarily before it crashes again.
Right, yeah.
So It's really, I mean, what does that tell us about not just domestic adoption, but also foreign adoption as well? Is the whole, like, currency exodus of China still driving it, or what's driving the price? Is it actually use, or are people using it as a kind of security like gold?
Yeah, and you also have to wonder about the war on cash. Mm. How's that affecting it? Because a lot of people, I mean, if you're going to push criminals out of cash, it seems like Bitcoin might be the next logical step.
Well, in case you're living under a rock, Snapchat IPO'd, and now it's apparently worth $33 billion.
$24 a share. Pretty crazy. Now,
so wait. What you're saying is that AMD is not worth as much per share?
Yeah.
Now, there was a, in history, I believe in the early 2000s, we had some crazy tech IPOs. Can't remember how that turned out.
It was probably fine. It's probably nothing bad happened with that. It's probably all right.
So, yeah, run out and get those Snap shares. No, don't do that.
Well, Moscow has got a billboard that targets ads based on the car that you're driving.
So these billboards, they see you coming, they measure the distance, and during that time, they actually have machine learning that is figuring out what ad is most applicable to, a Ford Fiesta.
I want to know what ads you get in like a Pinto or something. That would be amazing.
So it's going to be funny to see. People are going to be really offended by this, I'm sure. People with crappy cars, to see like what ad do you get in just the word, like an 80s model or something, Corolla.
It's like, no, I was just like,
that'd be funny if your car was so shitty that it would just like return to blank screen, like air does not compute.
I seem to recall some like really bad science fiction movies where something like this would happen, and it might have been Japanese movies or something, but when the person was walking along, it was like, oh, this person doesn't have enough money to buy anything, and so everything just turned off. They didn't even want to advertise at them. Just like, wow, you're not even worth advertising to.
You're not worth the electricity to run the screen.
Yeah.
For this couple of seconds.
I think the filmmaker might have been trying to convey that it's like you're worthless as a human being, and all of the technology around you is going to reinforce that.
But I think what they would do is just do car advertisements.
Get a better car.
Yeah, right.
Mortgage your soul so that you can
no
go
money
into debt
down.
Forever. Yeah, that's great. That's the American way, right?
You could do like the, no matter, you get $500 for your trade, no matter how crappy it is, one of those car dealership sales.
Well, I used to think that it really didn't matter if you were insanely wealthy, but SpaceX has proved me wrong because two people apparently are going to go fly around the moon in the first commercial moon flight.
There were a couple of moon stories this week. This one, I don't see the appeal of flying around the moon. Do you? I mean, I would want to land and do stuff.
I got a really interesting insight. There's a book, I can't remember what it's called, but it was about the Adelphia guys, like real insight into like what the Adelphia guys did to bankrupt Adelphia. And it was the most amazing pissing contest between like two or three executives on who could buy or do the most outlandish stuff. And I feel like that gave me some insight into this type of psychology. So it's like SpaceX is like, we'll be more than happy to take your probably hundreds of millions of dollars to, take you on a flyby around the moon. We'll be more than glad to do that. You guys can go down in history as the, the first millionaires or billionaires to afford, 400,000 kilometer flight away from the Earth. So I guess, if you've got $500 million laying around or $1 billion or $100 million or whatever the price of this lunar trip ticket was, I mean, it's the ultimate bragging right at a rich person party, I guess. It's like, oh, who needs an elephant foot umbrella stand? I had a trip around the moon or whatever.
I could totally see, that old trick where it's like the net versus the gross in Hollywood movies? Where it's like, we'll pay you this if the movie makes money. And then they spend so much, they guarantee the movie's never going to make money.
Yeah.
No matter how successful it is. You could really sink some money into some moon trips. And then it's like, well, I've directed 5 movies and I've had 4 trips around the moon.
That was sort of the end thing in the 70s was to go and direct movies for like the super wealthy. Isn't that how Ed Wood got his thing going or something? I don't know. Plan 9 was great. Maybe I mean the operating system. I don't know. Who knows? Could be worse.
Now, Amazon also has moon plans. In this case, nobody's going. This is going to be an automated. This is going to be like an Amazon Prime delivery to the moon. And they want to set up a base for return trips.
Jeff Bezos could get into an accident with like Mr. Freeze, and I'm pretty sure that would be Dr. Evil for his moon base.
Yeah, he definitely, I love Amazon. I'm not going to stop using it, but he seems like a terrible human being. He's got that Washington Post and he's just using it like a bludgeon, fake newsing it up.
I like that space travel and commercial space travel is here. I mean, finally somebody has told these guys that there's, oil on the moon or whatever. That's good. probably for society. But I, you know, there's still a downside with this because of the people involved. I have high hopes for Elon Musk, but Jeff Bezos, I don't know.
I don't know about Elon Musk. But now the next story covers exactly what you're talking about, because not only is there a danger in terms of, you know, like corporate control of the moon and stuff like that, but they could drop rocks on us from the moon. So Brianna Wu, who is apparently famous in the SJW transgender world and is also running for Senate, she warns that rocks dropped from the moon could destroy Earth cities. It could be a catastrophe. Now, as far as I understand it, what you do is you get rocks and you go to the edge of the moon. We all know where that is, right? And then you push them over so that they fall onto the Earth. Makes perfect sense.
Okay. What's going on there?
I believe that is a strong female protagonist video game design. Maybe she's going to protect us from the moon rocks.
Huh. Well, Apple is expanding its war with Qualcomm. So this is interesting. We reported on Apple filing suit against Qualcomm because apparently Qualcomm charges Apple more than anybody else, or at least that's what Apple alleges, I guess. So this was interesting.
It's more patent violation. It's not really anything new. It's just that this court case is now in the UK, where the rest of them have been in the US.
So it's a war on two fronts for Apple, I guess.
And, you know, based on their previous success, who can blame them, you know?
Now, we reported on the right to repair previously, although we got some flack because we didn't get it exactly right, which is okay. But the video game industry is now also lobbying against your right to repair consoles.
There's a group, and all the big names are in it, Sony, Nintendo, Microsoft, etc., and they're pretty much, they have the same line as Apple does. You are not allowed to fix it. You let us fix it, and we'll charge you for it. And they're doing everything they can to lobby against. So a couple of states actually have right to repair bills that are going through. It's actually, if you, from a legal standpoint, when you buy a console and you turn it over, and there are those stickers where if you take them off, it says void warranty, and the screws are under there. So you can't take a screw out, but that's not legal. But no one has ever fought it, because who's going to fight it? You know, do you have a war chest to go against Microsoft or whatever? And so they want to make sure that these bills that are pushed through don't actually enforce those laws and say, hey, you can't do stuff like that.
Now, one of the big things in the right to repair bill that we missed last time was that it would require manufacturers to sell replacement parts. So that you can obtain parts for things that commonly go wrong. And thinking back to like the Xbox, the original Xbox and the Xbox 360, there were a lot of relatively easily solvable manufacturing defects in those consoles, where if you knew the problem, you could very easily solve the problem. Things like defective solder joints, things like defective capacitors. It's really easy to service those and get it dealt with in an aftermarket kind of a way, as long as the parts are available. Now, in the case of like the original Xbox, it's like, yeah, just replace some capacitors and you're good to go. But the right to repair people do need some parts in some cases. So like the Apple MacBook Pros that had the defective GPUs, in an ideal world, you would desolder the defective GPU chip and solder a new one on. But if NVIDIA or Apple are not willing to cooperate, the only place you're going to get the replacement chips is by harvesting it from old devices. Apple's also recently taken to marrying some of the parts together so that when you've got like a fingerprint sensor, the fingerprint sensor has its own little processor or memory or whatever inside it that will sort of marry up to the phone that it's originally paired with. And so there was a firmware update that would brick some Apple phones if you had an aftermarket fingerprint repair from one of these type places. And it was like, that was an unauthorized repair. We're gonna brick that. And so those kinds of things can be avoided if consumers have an explicit right to repair their devices.
And it does cost them a lot of money. You can be sure they wouldn't spend this much effort on it if this was not, you know, something that if consumers get, it's very pro-consumer, and it costs them quite a bit in terms of Now, there's a lot of people who really will just throw it away and get another one. You know, they don't want to be bothered with it. But if you could take it to the local shop and spend a third of the price and get it fixed, they probably would.
Yeah, there's also, you know, the argument that they might lose trade secrets or that there might be, you know, intellectual property or something that would otherwise that would get out to competitors and things like that. But, you know, that's really an invalid argument with Apple because they're only using ancient technology for their stuff anyway. So not really a big deal. It's like, oh, yeah, Haswell laptops, woo. Not really, Skylake, but close enough. I'm kidding. Jesus. Lithium-ion battery inventor creates a solid-state battery that holds 3 times the charge. Now, this is an octogenarian.
Yeah, it's like 87. Still going strong. It's not only is it 3 times the charge, it's fast. So they replaced the liquid component with a glass component, which if you use liquid, it creates little tendrils during fast charge that will eventually meet and short circuit. But the glass prevents that. So there's no like immediate use for this, but hopefully they'll go forward and, you know, make it.
Shout out to anybody that happened to run a data center that the data center electronics would form little brass. I think they were brass. I can't remember, but they would form little tendrils and sort of short everything out eventually. And it's like, why is the failure rate with this really high? And you look at it under a microscope and there are these metallic tendrils that are sort of growing and shorting everything out. And so maybe we should use glass on that too. I don't know. I don't know what I'm talking about. It's fine. It is a nice breakthrough because I would like to have a battery in my phone not catch on fire and probably also not spray me in the face with glass shards, you know. Yeah. Samsung.
Plus, considering, you know, we're going toward the electric car revolution, 3 times more charge and faster charging seems like that would make the adoption rate for those way higher.
Oh, the Nintendo Switch is now out, and if you're, you know, you grew up on Nintendo, you can relive Nintendo games.
See, I don't know. Lately, Nintendo's behavior has left a bad taste in my mouth.
Yeah, I didn't buy the Wii U. I did buy the Wii, and then after that, I was just sort of disappointed in what Nintendo does. And it's like, I've really got a soft spot for Nintendo, but I can't condone their behavior, and so I'll do without. I bear my cross. It's fine.
So the story isn't whether or not the Switch is good or not. The story is they treat the cartridges with some sort of chemical agent that makes them very disgusting tasting. Now, they do this to keep young children from eating them, obviously. But
that was a problem with the original Nintendo, too. Kids were getting choked on the original Nintendo cartridges.
What size were these children?
No, I'm just kidding.
But, of course, you know, it's the modern age, and when you tell people not to do something, what do? They immediately do it. So licking Nintendo cartridges has become a meme.
See, I think this is actually like this is classic, you know, Japanese science fiction plot. Let me lay out what actually happened for you. What actually happened is that like Miyamoto or somebody is like actually just a mad genius, and Nintendo is sort of tired of being sort of like, you know, having the reputation of not like the powerhouse consoles. And so they developed a really powerful mind control drug. And the journalists that are reviewing the new device have to report that it's the most amazing device ever. And so in order to do that, we need to, you know, administer this mind control serum. And what better way than the coating of the cartridge?
So you're saying it's like a poison arrow frog.
Yeah.
You lick it and you get some sort of experience.
Oh. Yeah.
Now that would, if you could put hallucinogenics on cartridges, what a bestseller that would be. You know, you lick it, you put it in, you experience the game, bright lights and colors.
Zelda as best experienced on hallucinogenics.
And plus, think of the resale. Because like 7th, 8th time you power that up, you know, it's going to be wearing off. You got to get a fresh hit.
I'm convinced that the only thing that explains things like Teletubbies is hallucinogenics. So a Teletubbies video game could make sense.
The people that were raised on the Teletubbies are getting old enough now to be out there in the world.
Well, that's how we have our mind. Like, that's probably the evil mad scientist's like second lieutenant is somebody that grew up on Teletubbies, and so together they hatched the plan. This is great. We could turn it into a short story. It'd be awesome.
Are you a supporter of $15 an hour minimum wage?
Because if you are, you're going to be getting a lot more bad short stories from the people that are no longer working at Wendy's.
Fake fiction. Wendy's, and they're not the first to experiment with the self-order kiosk, but they have announced, because of wage inflation, this is directly related. The guy gave a speech and he was like, I've talked to the franchisers. It's a problem. Here's what we're going to do about it. So 1,000 Wendy's will now have self-order kiosks.
The story about Bill Gates and like robots being taxed for replacing jobs and that kind of thing sort of echoes in my mind a little bit here. This stuff that Bill Gates was saying in a video where it's like, if this happens overnight, it's going to be upheaval for society. But at the same time, I'm looking at this and it's like, do we really want to doom a generation to having to do restaurant service like this? Like, is it better? Like, just if all things being equal, is it better to try to keep these kinds of jobs, or is it better to replace those kinds of jobs because the people that working at Wendy's may be brilliant fiction writers, or they may be brilliant, you know, at something other than running the fast food thing at Wendy's? I don't know.
Yeah, but who's going to buy the fiction?
Yes, that's a problem. Well, presumably the people at Wendy's that are paying taxes on the robots, because then something, and then it's like the underwear pants from South Park. Something happens in the middle with question marks, and then the step three is utopian society.
Also, when you talk about Bill Gates, the big globalist, he's a guy who is responsible for all the manufacturing jobs being gone. So you have more people working at Wendy's to try to survive, and now you have robots that are going to replace the people at Wendy's.
I wonder if he's looking at that and being like, oh God, I helped bring about the robot revolution through more, you know, I laid the groundwork for more sophisticated software. I'm going to end society as we know it.
I think so. I think he's terrified that people are going to put that together and murder him.
I'd be very unhappy with him. Well, I mean, if the Ryzen launch is any indicator, I mean, people that are just running GTA benchmarks apparently were getting death threats. So yeah, that's probably going to happen. I mean,
people are pretty, they have strong opinions about technology. So I assume, you know, the Neo Luddites will be coming soon. I expect it to happen when the truckers get replaced. That's the tipping point.
We got to give the truckers something else to do before we replace them.
Yeah, that's because that's a lot of people.
That is a lot of people. And you don't want to mess with like the trucker unions, let me tell you. Man, yeah. that's gonna be a mess. Well, maybe we can work on the construction workers first. This is a 3D printing a house with concrete.
This happened in Russia, and this is not the first 3D printed house. There have been other 3D printed houses, but what they usually do is they print them in pieces and then assemble them at the site. In this case, they just brought the machine and put it on a crane and made this thing in 24 hours where it is now.
Now, the interesting thing about this 3D printer is that it operated in kind of a circular fashion from the central pivot. And so the head would deposit, you know, the concrete and then sort of come in. And there's this sort of odd shape, I guess. And like, this is the door, like they put the door here. But that gives you a really interesting internal. And you should check out the video on that if you're interested in this kind of construction methodology and this sort of thing. I mean, this looks really straightforward and like a really interesting piece of technology. I wonder if it could be combined with, like, you know, cities that are so upset with their homeless situation that they'll give you like free bus tickets to somewhere else. I mean, maybe it's like, well, you know, we're going to give you a bus ticket to a house out in the country 3D printed with concrete. I don't know. I don't know if that would help those people.
That shape also, I bet, makes it modular because you could just interlock.
Oh, yeah.
So, because this, the drawback here is a little tiny house. I imagine one of those sections is a bathroom, but the pictures they show, it's just like one room.
Yeah.
But it's $10,000, yeah, and it's made of concrete. So there's no maintenance. There's no gutters. I mean, look at that thing. I would love one of those.
Maybe we can rent the machine and just deploy it. Because I get the feeling that most of the cost is probably not around the concrete or the machine. It's most of the internals, like the wood flooring and the finishing stuff.
Right, yeah. Well, they mentioned that a similarly sized house made of wood and stuff it's very close in cost because it's a little tiny house. But in terms of like longevity, I think this one blows it out of the water because how long is this thing going to last?
Well, if you use the high pressure PSI, weather resistant, expansion, crack resistant concrete, it will be here after the next nuclear war.
So, that's really cool. I hope that catches on. I would love to have a 3D printed house.
And finally, if you'd like to just, you know, if the partisanship and general insanity of everyday life is just too much for you, well, good news. you can freeze yourself and they can thaw you with no problems, pretty much, apparently.
Well, not quite. They've only managed to do this with tissue samples. But previously, the problem with freezing things, human things, is when you thaw it out, ice crystals form. And having ice crystals form inside you, as you might expect, is bad. You don't want that. But they've found this new method of doing it with magnetic fields and nanoparticles. It's really impressive stuff. And so as far as tissue samples, they can now thaw them with zero damage.
Yeah, it's if you guys have any like an inductive stove at home where it's like you touch it and it's not hot, but you put a metal pot on it and it gets hot. It's kind of like that, except instead of being a pot, it's teeny tiny nanoparticles. And they say that, oh, you can totally wash those nanoparticles off and it totally won't cause cancer later. It's completely fine. But the testing actually was really small scale. So this is a really, you know, a really brand new technology, and it's not really been tested. I guess it was tested on mice or something. But they also did a test on, not on tissue, but like a larger sample container with the nanoparticles, and then attempted to use the nanoparticles to generate heat. But the thing is, the nanoparticles are the things that get hot. But because they get hot in a perfectly uniform way, it prevents you from having hot and cold spots, which I guess is the current problem with cryogenics, is that when you start to thaw somebody, there are spots that are colder and spots that are warmer, which creates the freezing problem. So this prevents that.
You know who needs to get in on this technology? Is Hot Pockets. Because they'd never heat uniformly. Never.
Take a bite out of it and just sprays you in the face. Yeah, I mean, but we've been eating those nanoparticles all this time. It's taken about 20 years.
I'm sure that this will pave the way for somebody being frozen. And I mean, there are already people who have their heads frozen and stuff like that.
Ray Kurzweil's backup plan.
He's probably excited about this. How old is he now?
He's getting up there. He looks good, but he's getting up there.
Whatever he's doing is working, but I feel like there's going to be some price to pay eventually.
Well, yeah, I mean, the current thing is like the blood of the young, and there was an article, we didn't include it, but there was an article that we saw that's like, are wealthy people already using the blood of the young to roll back the aging process? Because apparently there's something to that.
Well, that takes care of the robot joblessness overpopulation problem.
And that's pretty much it. This is going to probably be a content-heavy week. We've got motherboard reviews of the Aorus, the Gigabyte Aorus AX370 Gaming 5, and the ASRock Taichi X370, both Ryzen boards. We've got, hopefully, we'll be able to finish our like Ryzen overview benchmarking video, where it's going to be less about benchmarking, more about Linux, and more about the computer science of the Ryzen architecture, at least just a touch of computer science to understand the architecture, to understand some of the challenges that, you know, operating system engineers are facing with the updates and things like that. So this is probably going to be a really busy week for us.
Stay tuned.
We'll see ya. Look for us in the forums. And if you're really bored, you can find my tweets or whatever, but it should be good. Yeah, that's pretty much it for the news. We'll see you later.